Divine Truth Events. These are events and presentations by Jesus and Mary. This presentation is part of the Relationship with God series. The topic is Understanding Your Emotional Self, presented by Jesus and Mary Magdalene on the 8th of February 2014 in Kentucky, New South Wales, Australia. This is Session 1, Part 2.
Maybe we could talk about the second part of this, which was about when we see, and it's very much related, but there's some other things that we wanted to mention.
So the second part is?
When we see emotions as a means to an end.
Yeah, maybe I should write that a bit better.
Who can relate to seeing emotions as a means to an end? Yeah. And what's the end? At one-ment. What else? Some people don't have that end.
But when we say at one-ment with God, we're being pretty vague, aren't we? Because at the end of the day, most of us have never been at one with God before, so we have no idea what that means. So it's just an imaginary place, really, for most of us at this point in time. And while other people might have done their best to try and describe to you what that place is going to feel like, at the end of the day, if you don't feel anything, you're not going to be very connected to the description, right? Yeah.
And as we said before, lots of people see at one moment as a place where there's no emotion. So that end is not really realistic.
Eloisa?
Mine's just that I might be happy at the end of it. It's not even a certainty for me.
So you see the end as happy.
Yeah.
Yep.
Or a little bit of joy or something that's better than where I am now.
And emotions are the means to that end.
Yeah.
But aren't they emotions?
Well, yeah.
So how do you have an emotion that's a means to an emotion? I don't know
that's
about
a better
that.
Logical,
not very logical. If we think about it logically even, we see there's something wrong with our thinking here because they are emotions. So aren't we saying emotions are a means to emotions? No, that doesn't make much sense. Like, the reality is they are emotions, so the end is emotional. Can you see? Right. Even if we don't have a concept of God or a concept of anything, oftentimes the goal in our life is to become happy, right? Isn't happy an emotion? So, but often we don't see it that way, right?
We think, I'll just feel all my sadness so then I can have the happy emotion and block out the sad. It's not really logical in that the only way to get happy is to stay open to feeling sad.
And happy.
Yeah, well, that's one of my experiences. I find it's hard to be happy or joyful. Well, in the last little while, it's kind of just been happening, which is kind of nice. But in general, I'm trying real hard to have any emotion. And the happy doesn't, like I'm as scared of the real happy as I am of the real fear. Yeah.
So a key of this is trying rather than
doing it, experiencing.
Yeah, doing or experiencing. If we have to try, it means that we have some beliefs that that are flawed with regard to our emotion.
Right. Yeah.
Yep. Okay. Anything else, Paul?
To get all our fear out of us, to be free of fear.
Yes. So it's a means to be fearless in the end. Yeah. Yeah. And while that is partly true, you know, feeling your emotions is a way that you will eventually become fearless. At the end of the day, that's not the end goal. The end goal is far greater than that.
Yeah. And can you see how within it, it demonstrates a prejudice against certain emotions? So it's saying, I just want to be free of this yucky emotion, fear. And if the process is to open ourselves up to emotion, we've already got a prejudice against one of them in that we don't like it. Whereas in this change of state thing that we're talking about, we'll say, I want all emotion because it's an expression of who I am right now.
So what are those bad emotions you? Well, the ones you've been defining as bad. Fear.
Anger.
Shame.
Humiliation.
Yes.
guilt, powerlessness,
guilt, hatred. Yeah, which is seething rage, isn't it? And what are the good emotions?
Joy.
Happy. Love.
I can see some that people see as a good emotion that I often question. Comfort. Being free of any discomfort.
Yeah, so you can see some of these are pretty distorted as well, right? Because, again, the way we think. We think these are good, these are bad. The other ones you don't want to have, these are the ones you want to have. Sex is in there.
That could be a boat.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that could be a boat. I agree. And in fact, to be honest, some of these can be swapped around quite a lot for some people, right? You know, some of them like good emotion, anger. It feels good, powerful, you know, like we're so distorted in our judgments of emotion that you've really just got to give up judgment of emotion. So you just feel them. Stop judging every one of them. Some of the ones you think are bad are actually good. Some of the ones that are good and you think are good, they'll actually leave you and you'll never have them again. And you won't miss them either, by the way. You know, that's bound to happen. But at the moment, because of the way we've been taught, we have no idea of that. We have no idea of that. So really, for most of us, the way we've been seeing is emotion is emotions are a means to the end of not feeling those and feeling those. And we don't even really know which one of those are in harmony with God or not, to be honest, because we haven't felt enough to know.
We're very selective,
yes. So, you know, we don't. Some of us think anger is good, but from God's perspective, it's not that crash hot. Some of us think sexual stuff is bad, but actually from God's perspective, it's pretty good. Right? Some of us think being safe is good, but safety and addiction to safety is, from God's perspective, it's pretty bad. So, you know, like we're even mixed up about what's what. So what we have internally, and each of our lists are different, internally each of you have a list of bad emotions and good emotions, which have been totally defined by your environmental experience. They got no relevance whatsoever in your relationship with God, most of them. They've just been defined by your emotional experience. Or, we should say, been defined by the suppressed experience. If you had been allowed to experience some of these emotions, you wouldn't be so complicated about having them. Right? But most of us were never allowed to experience these emotions. And now that AJ comes along and says you're allowed to, what do you feel then? You go, I'm allowed to. I don't feel like I'm allowed to. That doesn't compute very well, right? My belief system from my childhood, I wasn't allowed to. I was punished violently most of the time, every time I experienced an emotion. So that told me I wasn't allowed to. I was harmed generally when I felt an emotion. I was humiliated when I felt a good emotion and I expressed it. So I'm not allowed to even feel a good one. Right? So when AJ comes along and says, you're allowed to feel an emotion, the internal belief system is even completely in opposition to that. You're really, internally you're going, what an idiot. What fancy saying that? My experience has been completely opposite of that. My experience has been in my childhood, I wasn't allowed to feel that. I wasn't allowed to feel this. I was punished when I felt that. I was violently abused when I felt that. I was sexually abused when I felt this. And we've got all these things going on. All of the things that happened in our childhood, right, that we weren't allowed to experience or we were suppressed or harmed in some way is what we believe right now. So how can you think clearly? How can you intellectually believe that your thought process has clarity? It doesn't have clarity. And the more that's happened to you, the less clarity probably it has. The more you've been suppressed, the less clarity you probably experience. Right? And you've got to come to awareness of that, The only way clarity can occur is by allowing the experience of all emotion. That's the only way clarity will ever be arrived at. So some people ask me, why is it that you seem to know what I feel when I'm talking to you? Because I have some clarity. Why do I have some clarity? Because I've let myself feel those emotions you haven't. That's what's given me clarity. Does that make sense? Okay. So can you see this means to an end thing? It's telling us, isn't it, that we see emotions as a process, not as an end destination. And if we're going to see emotions like that, then you can see that obviously you're going to be very selective about what emotions you feel. And this is why most of us are selective. Because we don't just let us feel everything. We only are allowed to feel certain things. And when we say allowed, sometimes our external environment allows, but most of the time it's our internal environment, our internal belief systems that allow. In other words, there are emotions that you have bottled up right now that you feel absolutely terrified of feeling, and I think if you could just feel that, your next bit of life would be so good. If you could just let yourself feel it. And you go, no, it's too bad to feel, it's worse. It's better not feeling it. Okay, how can it be better not feeling it? You're carrying it around with you every day. It's affecting every choice you make, every decision you make, every interaction you have, every relationship you have, every belief you have, every interaction with the universe around you is affected by that emotion. Like, surely, it's better to just feel it and let it go. And then it doesn't affect you anymore. But inside of ourselves, we go, no, we can't do that. We even don't even know why we can't do that half the time. We don't even understand why we feel so much like we can't do it. Because that's also an emotion that we got from our childhood that we're not feeling. Okay. So, what do you feel about all that so far? Come on. Practice feeling. Feel. What do you feel about it? Freedom. No, you don't.
Yeah.
No, you don't. Feel what you really... Don't be dishonest inside yourself. Get the mic. See? Right.
Yes?
If you felt free from what I just said, you would already be bawling your eyes out.
Okay, yep.
Right? Because there's grief in you that you need to experience, yeah, that you are not experiencing. So you don't feel that. So what do you feel? I do know that you feel encouraged, which is a different emotion, right?
Yeah.
So you do feel encouraged, yes? Do you feel that?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Anything else you can feel that you're actually feeling right now?
Well, getting back to freedom, I feel that there's a sense of seeing that there's freedom in embracing this.
Okay. So there's a feeling of hope that's developing within you about embracing a life where you just feel all the time.
Yes.
Right? So I agree with that. Yeah, I can feel that in you. Yeah. I don't feel you feel freedom yet because you feel bound up by a lot of your emotions, right? So you won't feel freedom for a while. Does that make sense? But you feel encouraged and hopeful. That's good.
Yes. Yeah. Yep. What else do I feel? I think there's an intellectual, which I know we're not supposed to go to the intellect, but there is an intellectual deepening of understanding of what the process,
what the process is. Let's call it the process.
What the journey is.
No, see, let's call it process. And journey is just another word for process, isn't it?
Well, it's,
Aren't they the same thing? Really?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay. Don't be afraid of using terms that come to you automatically. They tell you a lot about yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand?
Yeah.
So every time you go, process, oh, no, not that word, because AJ doesn't like that word, I'll use another word, yeah. Right? All you're doing is modifying how you really feel. How you really feel still is it is a journey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And a process.
So, yeah, rather than a destination, like emotions being the destination. And it's going to be quite difficult for some of you to change this concept from an emotional perspective, from it being a journey to a destination. Emotions are the destination. And to be more concise, emotions that are completely 100% experienced and in harmony with God's love are my destination. And they don't have to be yours. That's my destination. That is not a process. Or you could say the process is learning how to do that. Do you see? So it's not dealing with emotions. It's learning how to make emotions 100% of my life. That's the process. The destination is emotions being 100% of my life. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And the process is learning how to make that happen. And what I've been trying to do for 6 years is explain to you how that happens.
You have.
And many of you have misinterpreted my words and turned it into a process.
Equally, yes, I have.
Yeah.
I think it's very important what you just said there, babe, about the process actually learning how or coming to this state of humility again. And I see a lot of people talk about emotions, but they don't really talk about how they're going with making humility their way of life. When really, when we are striving on this path, that's what we're striving for. So we're not striving to cry 5 hours a day. We're striving to be humble all the time. And that a byproduct might be that we cry 4 hours a day.
And what's the definition of humility? So you've already been taught this, you see, but you just haven't realised it. Most of you haven't realised what you've already been taught. I've already saying to you, to progress towards God, you are going to have to be emotional 100% of the time. So the goal is, you could almost replace the words, couldn't we? The destination is what I'm saying, is all emotions in harmony with God's love 100% of the time. Now, isn't that a very similar description to humility in some ways, with one exception? And that is that humility allows you to experience all emotion, whether they are in 100% harmony with God's love or not. That's the only difference. Yeah. And the process is what? Learning humility, or learning how to do that. Any sense? Yeah. When we're humble, we don't see emotion as a process. We see emotion as the way in which we live the rest of our life. So we see it as a core intrinsic part of the way. If you have a discussion with a celestial spirit and you start talking about emotional processing, they'll go, what's that? I don't really get what you mean there. Right? And then you start saying, well, you know how you go through an emotional process and you come out of it at the end of the day? And they go, no. We don't come out of emotion. We're in it all the time. Does that make sense?
And I can see a lot of people have decided this idea, this way to progress on the path towards God is to deal with the unloving issues inside of us, so the suppressed emotion from our childhood. And while in theory that's true, it's skipping the really vital step that you've been talking about for 6 years, which is embracing humility. That's the only way you're ever really going to deal with those things. But I see that... Let me try and get this out clearly. I can see that everyone is focused on what I've cleared, the causal I processed, the bit of fear I did. And it's all about trying to achieve a goal of, like, getting rid of all that yucky stuff. And really, this process is about embracing all of that without resistance. And then you'll be free of those things. But you won't be focused on being free of them. You'll be focused on having your experience and honouring yourself emotionally. And if you want the destination that Jesus and I have, you'll want to do that with a desire to love and be in harmony with God's love.
Mm. Yeah. Mel? Just two down.
I was just going to say, well, you said focusing on being free of them, because I can relate to that. That's all about control, though, isn't it?
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fear and control. Well,
which is the main reason why you can't feel all of the emotion, right?
Yeah.
In the end, once you set up a desire to control, it's going to be very, very difficult for you to not be, you know, to not control the emotions you don't want to feel.
Totally.
You know, it's just like...
And for me, control has been intrinsic. Like, it wasn't until this path I was aware of how controlling I actually am.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And for a lot of us, becoming emotional is going to mean breaking down a lot of the old habits that we use to not be emotional. So in other words, most of the work we'll finish up doing, once you get to the point where you're willing to be emotional almost 100% of the time, you'll find things a lot easier. Getting to that point is the hardest thing.
Yeah.
And the majority of people, that's where the majority of people are struggling, getting to the point.
Yeah. And just what you were talking about when you were separating, well, how you feel a lot of us are separating sadness, anger and fear.
Yeah.
I feel in relation to fear, I sometimes feel afraid to feel it in public because I feel like I'll just cry the whole time. Yeah. And I try and get into, what am I crying about? What am I sad about? But really, the sadness is just fear.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Which I related to what Vanessa said. Mm. It's those, the anxiety tears. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's a block, Mel. You know, we're always talking about blocks.
Yeah.
That's a block that you both experience about connecting to the real feelings that you have.
Yeah.
And you have to feel blocks. You have to feel...
You can't intellectually decide your blocks and intellectually remove them.
I think I've just realised this 2 days ago.
Yeah. Okay. Is there any...
Vanessa?
I just wanted to clarify something with what you were saying, Mary. It seems to me the difference is it's a very egocentric state that we're all involved in. What AJ was saying on DVD the other night, we're talking about spirits and being open to feeling everything that is around you and all the emotions that are around you. I just kind of want to get rid of my stuff. I don't want to feel your stuff and...
But you see, when you truly allow all emotion, you will want to feel everyone's stuff.
So is that kind of... I've kind of got that right, like, instead of being egocentric.
Yes.
And that's why, particularly in the first century, when you're at one with God, people had that feeling of love.
Correct.
In the interactions.
Yeah, if I can point out that the majority of people who see emotions as a means to an end are narcissistic... Right? They're egocentric.
How would you differentiate the definition of those words, babe?
Well, they're both very similar, aren't they?
Yeah.
One is seeing the world, I feel, revolve around yourself, whereas narcissistic is more being totally interested in yourself.
Yeah. Right.
Do you see what I'm saying? And for most people who find the path, they go through these emotions where they don't really get rid of their narcissism or egocentricity. And you can see that with how addicted they become to interactions. Do you know what I mean? Like Facebook, Twitter, and all of these things have all become huge organisations on the planet because of those two emotions. People want other people to share in their experience. When you really feel all of your emotions... You'll own your own experience completely without sharing it, and you're happy for other people to share their experience. You don't need to share your own experience.
I've struggled with that a lot.
Yeah. And I feel even the desire to share your own experience is driven by another addiction of a kind. You know what I mean? They're all driven by addictions in the end. Mm. When we truly feel everything, what you will come to this realization that there is no way that you can properly describe anything you've felt. So talking about your emotions becomes demeaning of the emotion itself. So when I see people discussing their emotions and what they've processed and enjoying it, it shows to me they haven't really felt their emotions properly. Because when you truly feel your emotions, trying to describe it to another person is very, very difficult.
It's frustrating.
Almost
too.
Impossible.
Because you can't... It's impossible. Yeah,
it's impossible. Yeah. And that's even if the other person is your soulmate, it's very, very difficult. It's only once you get rid of the blockages between each other that you'll feel the actual emotion that the other person's experiencing. Does that make sense?
And then they won't even have to talk about it because you'll be feeling it from them.
Correct. Yep. You won't need to talk about it because you're feeling it from them. You know exactly what they're feeling. Yep.
And going back to your original question or point, I feel that the only way we become egocentric and narcissistic is because we don't want to feel alone. So it's impossible to have an egocentric view of processing. Oh, I'm just going to feel my stuff and not feel everyone else's stuff, because the very state is indicating that you don't want to feel your stuff, that you're trying to control everything and maintain a state that you have internally. That's why everything's about you. That's my experience.
And if we can
been very narcissistic at many times, and it's always because I'm afraid
of feeling something else.
So
if you could describe that as a picture, here's you, right? And what you're doing is there's lots of people around you who have emotions, right? Some of those emotions you don't like, right? At the moment.
Yes, that's
true. You don't want them to have those emotions.
No, particularly not about me either.
I'm going to feel what I feel about me, and I'm not going to feel anything else, right? But you can see that when you're at one with God, God feels everyone. Mm. God just doesn't agree with everyone. So there's a difference between feeling everyone and agreeing with everyone.
And God wouldn't see our error as us anyway.
But God still can feel what your error is. Mm. Does that make sense? He can feel whenever you're in a rage, but he doesn't agree with the rage. He doesn't agree it's necessary. Does that make sense?
I think so, because I've had a lot of feelings of commiserating, particularly with other women. Like those kind of addictions.
Yeah.
So
whenever we're trying to put a barrier around our own emotional experience, what we're trying to do is stop those people from having their experience, which affects our experience. Yeah. And from God's perspective, if it affects your experience, then it already means that you haven't healed something. So in other words, you being in a rage shouldn't affect my happiness. And if your rage does affect my happiness, then it means somehow I'm hooked into your rage. I've got an addiction that you don't get into a rage, or I want you to not be in a rage with me, or I want you to not be in a rage with my daughter or my son who you hate, or whatever my addiction is. Does that make sense? So if I'm responding to your rage, it's because I have an addiction about your rage. Do you see?
I think I do, yes.
If I'm responding unlovingly to your rage, it means I have an addiction about your rage. And this is why we need to allow ourselves to feel other people's feelings, because if there is a response in here somewhere, there is just something to heal. Once you've healed that, the other person can be in a rage, you'll be happy. They can be sad, you'll be happy. You know, a celestial spirit doesn't... When a celestial spirit feels for you, they don't... When you're crying about some child event, they're not sitting down with you crying.
Because I was trying to understand, and maybe you'll talk about that later with the positive side of things. You've walked in today and you've said, look, we've been really quite attacked. How does that feel? But from what Mary's been saying recently, that you fear, am I right in saying you feel better than you ever have in your life,
mm-hmm.
even though there's this huge attack, and the attack in the first century resulted in both your death, basically. So I'm going, feeling emotion, I'm going to be persecuted. And but your experience was different to how my perception of how the experience would be.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And sorry, you're going to say
no,
something?
No, fine.
Can you see that when you align yourself more with truth or with your feelings, you're going to feel better? Like before now, I've been trying to suppress my emotions really heavily, been quite narcissistic because my feeling state, I would allow about that much. And when I really don't want to go there, then it becomes paramount to me. I'm going to stay in this space. So everything's about me now. I've got to make sure this space is held, you know. And that takes work. It feels yucky. You're out of harmony with love all the time. You've got that weighing on your soul all the time. When you start to connect with yourself, and this is what I think a lot of people don't understand about just living humbly, you immediately start to have more joy just because you're not fighting yourself all the time, you know? And you also begin to have more faith in God's laws. And that's why I feel much better, because I'm starting to have experiences where I feel things, and then I feel the truth of God's laws, and I know that if I just keep feeling things, everything's going to work out the best that it could possibly work out.
Mm. But I also see attack as a way for me to feel some emotion that I'm obviously not connecting to.
But what about in the first century when you're at one with God and you didn't have those negative emotions to feel? So, but you had the experience. But are you saying, so were you sad that people were doing this to you, or?
No.
That's what I'm not.
If I am sad now, it's just stuff I have to feel, right? Okay. But when you get attacked all the time, you don't have to be sad all the time. You're only going to be sad when you're attacked, because you then have an investment in how other people perceive you, right? So the only reason why many of you feel sad when somebody says something bad about you, sometimes it's something that's true, either way, you know, you feel that it's bad, is because you have an investment in their opinion of you. Why do you have an investment in their opinion of you emotionally? Because you were taught to have one. You were taught that you couldn't, you know, stay true to yourself. And if everyone around you disagreed with you, you still stay true to yourself. So most of you have no idea how to do that at this point. In the first century, I knew how to do that. Once I became one with God, that's what I did. Your opinion of me didn't matter to me. I didn't invest in it. I didn't make my identity a part of your opinion of me. Does that make sense?
But that's a good example of how, you know, we're not going to get to a Zen space. Actually be attacked, and there might be law of attraction events that are really...
Yeah, I don't see the relationship. And again, I feel this is a distortion of your already concepts. The reality is I felt in a peaceful state even when I was being attacked. So I didn't see it as some kind of trauma or... You know, it was people around me often did, but I didn't.
But also, would you agree that you had an unwillingness to sacrifice love and truth, and a faith and a knowledge that by living in a way that didn't sacrifice love and truth, the best possible outcome could happen for everyone involved?
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people get really caught up in, but Jesus died, he was crucified, therefore, big question mark on this whole thing. Which is really, I feel, just indicating a huge fear of physical pain and attack.
And no understanding of my condition at the time I was receiving it.
Yeah.
I didn't feel attacked. They were attacking me, but I didn't feel attacked. I didn't invest in their opinions of me. So even if they hated me, I didn't think, oh, I'm a terrible person just because you hated me. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Whereas many of us today either think we're a terrible person if someone hates us, or we get really, really angry that someone hates us because we want them to think we're a nice person when they don't. And I didn't do that either. I was completely honouring of their emotional experience. If they were angry and they hated me, that's fine. That's where they're at. That's their choice to be there rather than feel an emotion. That was their choice. And I honoured their choice, right? I didn't agree with it in the sense that, you know, it was wrong. I didn't have to then accept. What I'm finding now, even the only time you generally get upset is that there is a feeling inside of you that maybe the other person was right. when that feeling disappears inside of you, you won't even invest in anybody's opinion. Everyone in the world could hate you and you still be fine. Does that make sense? And it won't be because you're totally zenned out and zoned out and totally oblivious to your own condition. It'll be full awareness of your own condition and you'll still be fine. Yeah. And that's what it felt for me in the first century like. It was like I was totally aware of my own condition. I knew God loved me. I could feel that love all the time. I knew there was nothing that could shake me from that. No opinion of another person could shake me from that space. And as a result, it was just a beautiful space to be in, whether I was getting attacked or not. It was immaterial what other people did to me. Does that make sense? My good feelings were enhanced through the emotional experience, and I didn't have any negative ones.
Sounds like a worthwhile place to,
exactly.
to get to.
And it doesn't matter what your environment does in that place. You know, I hear a lot of you say, but what if someone attacks me? And what if people pull me down? And what if my friends do this? So you're not going to feel any of that in the end. It's just going to be them feeling that. That's their pain, you know. They're going to be feeling their pain, but you're not going to be feeling it because all of the painful responses that you could have had to their pain have all gone. And so what we need to do in the interim is allow the painful responses to be experienced rather than reverting to some kind of action or negative response of our own. Kenny, we have a mic over there.
Does that mean no matter what anybody says to you about... Does that mean taking things to heart more?
Well, the interesting thing is, let's look at it from, again, a diagrammatic perspective. Here's myself, let's say. If inside of myself I feel unworthy, and somebody else from outside tells me I'm unworthy, or they would be saying it like, this is how they'd say it. They'd say, AJ is unworthy. And I get that quite a lot, right? I'm unworthy to be Jesus. I'm unworthy even to be myself from most people's perspective. So that's the message I get from the environment. Now, if that feels bad inside of me, right, if it feels bad, in other words, when I say feels bad, it feels like sad or I feel angry or I feel some kind of emotion that isn't harmonious with love, obviously, right? So it feels bad. Then all that tells me is that I must believe I'm unworthy, which is what I already feel anyway. That's all it tells me. Now, if I, in that place of feeling bad, decide to attack the person or the environment that's telling me that I'm unworthy, I have now taken an unloving action towards another person or environment, which now is going to make me feel another emotion, which is going to be negative. But this time it's going to be true. Do you understand? So this is where most of us get ourselves in a real problem, because we start taking action when we feel bad towards other people rather than just feel the emotion that they are triggering inside of ourselves. Now, once I no longer feel unworthy inside of myself, people can say AJ is unworthy, and what's AJ going to feel? There's no unworthy inside of me. So I don't feel anything about what they're saying at all. No anger, no sadness, no fear, no anything. So the fact that I feel something from what somebody else outside of me says is an indication that something's still inside of me. Does that make sense?
Does that mean you embrace what people say to you, and is that what you're trying to say?
I don't embrace the... is that a truth or an untruth from God's perspective? An untruth. So I don't embrace it as a truth, but I allow my feelings about it. That makes sense? So that's not embracing it as a truth. That's just allowing my feelings, feelings that are responding to those feelings coming from outside of me. Do you follow? That's all you're doing. If you allow the feelings, eventually this feeling of unworthiness will be released. Then there's no feelings of unworthiness within me. And then when anybody thinks I'm unworthy, it will just be like, it'll pass through me, but there's nothing to resonate with. So I'll still know that they feel this way about me, but it won't bother me in any way.
But then you'll have compassion for them.
Yes, you even get to the stage where you do have compassion that they could think such an amazing thing. Do you know what I mean? It's such an amazing thing. You're the pinnacle of God's creation. How could you ever be unworthy? It's such an amazing thing that somebody else thinks you're unworthy. That's how you feel at the end. Like, you go, wow, there must be some pretty sad things that have happened in their childhood to make them think that I'm unworthy. But it's not an intellectual place because you've released all of the feelings inside of you that it can resonate with. So what I see a lot of people doing in an intellectual way is they go, I'm worthy, I'm worthy, I'm worthy, I'm worthy. Someone treats them unworthy and go, ah, I'm worthy, I'm worthy. You know, like someone else treats them unworthy, ah, I'm worthy. You know, the response is the indication they don't think they're worthy. If they actually felt worthy, they wouldn't respond like that to every person who projects something that they're unworthy at them.
Does
that make sense?
Yeah.
Yep. So there is an emotion inside that just needs to come out, and the key is to feel it. And in the end, isn't the goal to be a 100% emotional being? So every time you shut down the feeling of it, you're just not meeting that goal anymore. You're not on the path to that goal. You're better off on the path to that goal than trying to shut down that. So what I see happening for many of us day to day, from a day to day basis, is that we sort of go like this. Let's call this our emotional tolerance scale, shall we? Emotional tolerance scale, ETS. Here's zero. All right, and this is our tolerance of any emotion, good or bad. All right, for most of us, it's that's how it goes. That's how it goes for most of us. We have very little tolerance to experience emotions. Now, when we are 100% emotional being, where's our emotional tolerance scale? Okay, so let's put it up here. All right. And between there and there is what you have to learn. Right. So it's not about your intellectual learning, it's about learning how to get from this level of tolerance to your own emotion to this level of tolerance to your own emotion. You get that? Yep. So that's what real progression is about, moving your tolerance level of emotion to the point where it's no longer a tolerance level, it's a emotional, after a while it becomes an ease. Emotional acceptance level. And then it becomes an EDS, emotional desire level. Oops, acceptance level. Should we call it an EEL? And an EDL. See, eventually it becomes, we start off being very emotionally intolerant. We learn to tolerate emotion. But that's still not where we need to be. We need to get to the place where we actually emotionally, we accept emotion. But even that's not the place where we need to be, because we need to get to the place where we desire emotion all the time. All right. Once we're there, now we can make some real progress. All right. And when you think about it, if there's a scales, you could say, right, here there's tolerance, ENCE, I don't know. Then there's acceptance. Is it ants or ants?
You're going to run into that issue all the way up this scale, aren't you?
Is it ants or ants?
Ants.
Acceptance, and then it's desire. right? And as we're going up this learning process, you will find, you will move through these layers. You'll move through from denial, which is where you start, to tolerance, to acceptance, to desiring it. And once you start getting to desiring it, now your progression in God's universe can greatly be improved. Because once you desire it, this is how God teaches you through your emotional experience. So everything you learn after that is about having to accept new emotions, right? And as a result of that, you're going to learn a lot of things. But if you can see that if you have a desire for it, it's going to happen a lot faster than if you just have an acceptance of it. And if you have a tolerance of it, that means that sometimes you like it, sometimes you just sort of barely, you might go from bare tolerance, barely tolerating it, to eventually going, okay, acceptance, okay, I have to accept that this is the way God made me. But that's still not very desirable. We're not very desiring in that place, right? And what you will eventually become is that, you believe it or not. Depending on what our emotional condition is now, some of us, for that to occur, we go, yeah, I can't see that ever occurring. That may be, it depends on where we are as to what we see. But in the end, you will get to that place where you actually desire to be in 100% emotional being all the time. And when you get there, then progression on every truth that God could give to you becomes like a wide open book from then on. Does that make sense? Everything that God could teach you, you desire to learn. When you're here, you're going, can I tolerate learning that? Probably not. Or probably yeah, or maybe. But you're very reluctant, right? But once you get to acceptance, you've gotten over your reluctance. So it's sort of like, yeah, I'm okay with it now, but I don't really want to know more. Whereas when you get to this place, you're going, I want to know more all the time. I want to grow my soul to be this expressive individual, which is an expression of my individual personality, but also which allows everyone around me to express theirs. Yeah. Okay. Who had their hand up? Teresa? That answered your question though, Kenny? Susan? Yep.
When you were writing up the scale,
yep,
and I realised the learning thing, I thought, oh, I've got a lot of doubt about that. Doubt that I can do it, doubt that I want it, doubt. But then as you were writing...
Can I have a quick chat about doubt?
Yep.
You know what doubt is?
Feels angry.
It is actually an anger, yep.
Yeah.
What does doubt allow you to do?
Blame others.
And stay...
Stay where I am.
Where you are. Most of us choose doubt. Doubt is a choice. We don't want to... When we're choosing doubt, we're choosing to not resolve a question. Yep. We're choosing to not have resolution. God wants us to have resolution on every issue. So when we doubt, we are basically choosing to not have resolution. And the only reason why we would choose to not have resolution is because we don't want to go through the process. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? The process of going from zero tolerance of our emotion to full desire of our emotion, we don't want to go through that process. And we've got to be careful that we don't say, oh, I doubt that, this is true, when really the feeling is I don't want it to be true. And doubt gets you away from having to say that. Do you see? If you go, oh, I'm not sure, what does it do?
You don't have to look at it.
Yeah, you don't have to look at it any further. You don't have to do anything about it. It lets you off the hook. Yeah. That's why we choose doubt. That's why we choose to remain unsure about anything. There are whole areas of the hells of the spirit world full of people who have done this. They've made it their profession in life. Do you understand? And it's a very dangerous place because it's very hard to move from there. Mm. It's driven by fear, but it's very hard to move because you keep justifying your lack of movement, your inertia. You keep justifying your inertia through saying, I don't know if it's true anyway. And you have no desire to resolve whether it's true or not in that place. Mm. The problem with this process from an emotional perspective is that the only way you're going to know it's true is by actually experiencing it. So can you see, by having doubt about it, you're even disallowing the experience to even work out whether it will be true or not in the end. See, a true scientist wouldn't do that. A true scientist would say, okay, I'm being presented with a theory here. I want to see whether it's going to work. I'm not going to doubt it. What I'm going to do instead is I'm going to choose to experience it and see whether it's true.
So looking at why the doubt is there?
Yes. Well, the doubt's all about one thing, an unwillingness to do.
Yeah, so why is there unwillingness?
Because you're afraid of something, obviously.
Yeah,
or you're angry. It could be any reason. There could be a thousand reasons.
So that would be the place to go.
Yes, but don't justify your doubt. Don't justify it. Don't say, the reason why I'm not doing this is because I doubt whether it's going to work. That's not a reason, right? That's an excuse.
Yep.
Doubt can be removed from within you by doing some kind of experiment to remove the doubt. See, a true scientist, if you think about it, all of us need to be a true scientist if we're going to engage the world we're in. A true scientist would go, I don't know whether this is true. So he's aware that he might not know something, but he doesn't decide to use doubt as a way of not finding out. Mm. What he does instead is he creates an experiment and then he engages the experiment to find out the truth. And if we were truly sincere about following any path, we would experiment with it rather than just doubting it works.
Okay. So I can feel I'm judging my doubt and thinking I can't move from there. So instead of just...
I'd start with rage, Teresa. Yeah. Doubt is a great way to avoid rage. Avoid the anger that I don't want to do it. I don't want to have to change. I don't want my life to be any different than it is because I'm afraid that all sorts of things might happen if it becomes different. You know, we're often a very angry place when we doubt, and we use doubt as a way of saying, I'm not angry, I'm just doubtful. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You know, I'm not angry, I'm not resistive. See, a person who's not resistive, even though they might not know something, they will create an experiment to find out.
Yep.
That's what a person who's not resistive does. A person who doubts is resistive, and so they don't create the experiment. Mm. They just say, I doubt that. And you say, what are you doing about your doubt? What do you mean, what am I doing about my doubt? I just don't believe it's true. I don't know if it's true. There's no way of knowing it's true. But well, I'm just saying there is a way of knowing it's true. You have to experience some emotion. You go, I doubt that. And can you see what happens with a person who uses their doubt as an excuse? Basically, in the end, it's very hard to have any meaningful conversation with them. Because anything you say, they're going to doubt.
Yeah.
Right? And it's very, very hard to have any resolution of any problem with a person who doubts. The most frustrating person, I doubt whether there's any real, scientist who actually does experiments doubting from the beginning. They have an imagination, they have a desire developed, they want to resolve the question. They are unsure about their knowledge from the beginning, but they don't use doubt as a way of avoiding the experiment. Mm. So you've got to be very careful with doubt.
Yeah.
It's just really a passive-aggressive way of expressing rage.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Make sense?
Okay.
It's almost time for a rest for me, for a break for 10 minutes or so.
I was just going to say, I looked at a lot of what you had there and I thought, oh, this is so true for me at the moment, a lot of it. And then I had this feeling of excitement mixed with this flutter in my chest with fear and all this kind of stuff. And after the experience that I had last Thursday with you guys, I thought, I'm going to try to see what this feels like. So I'd let myself feel or whatever I need to feel about it.
Yep.
And then I watched God's law of attraction go into supercharge.
Yep, as it does. Because your desire has increased.
And then it was like everything around me was constantly bringing up some feelings inside of me that I was constantly being challenged.
Mm-hmm.
And I've started to go into this place where I was feeling good, feeling bad, feeling good, feeling bad, feeling good because of my resistance, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And then now it's like,
you know, people are, I've noticed everyone's addiction to try to help me feel better, you know, and everyone's saying, oh, what's wrong? It's like, oh, I just need to feel. And then everyone in, well, basically in town, you know, where I work, constantly trying, because I had to keep removing myself from these people. And it just, like, felt like I was going to be completely alone in this whole process, which is something I've been feeling. But it made me, it showed me how much I didn't want to know certain things about myself, and that if I just let myself feel it, then I'd find out that, oh crap, that's true, you know. And like, then you noticed how many times you did it to everyone, and went, oh goodness, that's true too, and sort of understanding the belief that's not really who you are, but it's just what emotion's there.
So can I before you proceed further, just address one part of that?
Please.
I agree with all that, with one exception. That is that this feeling that you're going to be alone, feeling your life. The fact is, you are alone. So why do you find that sad?
Because it's just feels like it's true at the moment. That's why. I mean, emotionally, because of my beliefs.
Yeah, but see, only you can feel what you feel. No one else can do it. Even your soulmate can't do it for you. So when it comes to your feeling experience, you are alone in the sense that only you can feel what you feel.
And I want someone to be with me when I do it.
And at the moment, you feel that's a bad thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's a wonderful thing. I'm so glad that I don't have to feel your emotions. Oh, I have enough trouble feeling my own. And once you get to the point where you desire your own, you're also so glad that you don't have to process anybody else's emotions, go through the feelings and experience of everyone else's emotion. Because the reality is, every single one of us need to learn that we are an individual. And to be an individual means that you have to process or go through or experience your own emotion. That's the only way you can be an individual. So it's actually a great thing about free will and a great thing about what it means to be an individual. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
But you're not going to feel that while you feel lonely emotions.
I don't want to feel that loneliness in the first
Correct.
Place. Yeah.
Correct. So just because you feel alone and you feel sad about that, in the future, you will actually go through your emotional experiences alone and not feel sad about that. And this is what I'm saying about the distortion of our mind and what it does to our belief systems. You know what I mean? Like, now you feel sad about being alone going through your emotions. You will, at some point in the future, feel very glad that you're alone going through your emotions. Does that make sense?
Like, I don't want... I mean, there's an emotion in me that wants people to feel like to...
To share with
make
you.
Me feel better
in
my emotion.
Yeah, I understand.
And I get away, because I'm trying to experiment to get away from people to do it alone.
Yeah.
But it's in that place where I feel like, oh, it'd be good if I had someone that, you know, said, oh, that's all right, Fabian, you need to go there. And but I don't when I'm in that place.
I've never had anybody say that in my entire emotional experience. So I don't see... even that as being good. And the reason why I don't see it as being good is because in the end you don't learn to have your own emotional experience if somebody else goes...
It's like driving to Sydney and getting lost. Yeah, you've got to get...
Yeah. If you think about it, the person who goes through their own emotional experience in the end will learn to honour their own emotional experience the most. When you go through an emotional experience because somebody else has, you're not going to honour that experience as much. So one of the things I've noticed in terms of being the first person to go through an experience is that I now, as a result of that, have a very clear feeling about that experience that the people who have come after me don't have as much. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I see that as a blessing rather than a problem, actually. So, I feel this issue of wanting other people to share the experience and feeling alone when they don't is just another addiction that needs to be felt.
It just blew me away because I felt the excitement about and the inspiration about what you're saying, but at the same time the fear inside me and of where I need to just feel about. But.
Yeah. What I love about this concept, and this is a concept that I realised way early in the first century, by the way, was that it gave me the power to live in a world without taking on the world or the world's feelings about me. Does that make sense? And it allowed me to grow independent of whether other people were willing to grow or not. Right? When you see your emotion as a destination, you don't see living somewhere as a destination. You don't see being in the spirit world in a certain location as a destination. You don't see any of that. You just see being present as yourself, fully 100% feeling as the destination. So now your focus becomes, what can I do to become that? Rather than what can I do to do some other things, you know, that are nowhere near as important as that. When you fully engage your own emotional experience and you become an emotional being 100% of the time, you'll find in the end that the results will be so amazing for you that other people will be automatically attracted to want to know what you did. Right? But you won't feel like you are responsible for them even. You won't even have to share with them if you didn't want to, but you probably want to, right, in that place. And what I love about this too is you realise, and what I feel often happens for most people on the path at this stage who are intellectually following it, is it almost feel, I can feel the hopeless feeling that many of you have. A real hopeless feeling about, I don't know if I'm ever going to get through this stuff. And when you look at it this way, as this just a way of expanding yourself emotionally that is going to be a forever proposition, you don't sort of place time frames on it. You just focus your attention on growing every day more emotionally. So life then becomes very simple. Do you know what I mean? Like, even your decisions in each day are focused first on growing emotionally. And then the other things, you decide upon other things based on your desires or based on those emotions that you experience. You don't focus on doing things external all the time. You don't focus on changing the world around you. You don't focus on any of these things because you're so absorbed in the fact that you know that this is the key to your own happiness, but also the key to other people experiencing your happiness. Yeah. Like, if I'm not happy, you can't experience me being happy, right? So that applies to all of us. If you're not happy, somebody around you can't experience you being happy. You being happy is the way God created you to be in the long run. So really, none of us are really experiencing the other person very well, right, at this point. Once you get into desire of all of your emotions, now people experience the real you. You experience the real you, but they also experience the real you. They get to know who you are, your true nature, your true feelings, your true abilities and desires, your true personality, everything they get to know and see really easily. Right? Because you allow the expression of such things because you're in emotional desire all the time. Yeah? And it's such a lovely place to be, such a lovely place to be. And what I'm trying to encourage you in this discussion, and we'll have more discussions along the line over the weekend, is to stop seeing emotions as a process and start seeing your emotional self as the destination. Because if you can do that, you will start, you will change what you do every day even then. You will. You won't any longer be trying to avoid emotional experiences or control them all the time. You'll be wanting to feel them instead. You know? And that is going to make a huge difference to your life. And that's also how you're going to feel God, because that's what God does. God's the great emotional experience. And that's how you're going to feel God, by allowing these emotions to flow all the time. Yeah. So perhaps what we need to do is have a break. What's the time, by the way? for us. Yeah, I'd probably like to finish off there, actually, I think. And maybe what we'll do is this second half of our conversation, it's really probably more than one half we've got to go, because we want to talk to you about the attitude to growth and progression as well in this discussion. So probably what we'll do tomorrow is talk to you about how you see progress. What do you imagine it to be? Because how you currently imagine it to be is causing you a lot of pain. And what we'd like to see it differently, right? And the way to see it differently is all about how we see the emotions. And what we would like to be able to do is tomorrow is discuss with you this concept of the difference between an intellectual concept of growth compared to actually emotionally growing, and see the difference between those two concepts and show you how, you know, what kind of thinking that we have when we compare those two different types of growth. And to be honest, I don't think intellectual growth is even a method of growth. That's my personal opinion, although I do admit that people have grown intellectually to the point of the sixth dimension. Does that make sense? But it's a very limited method of growing. And it's a limited method of growing that most of us are still engaging, even though we've heard about divine truth and even though we've heard about divine love. We are still engaging this intellectual method of growing, most of us. And what I'd like to encourage you to do over the tomorrow when we have this second discussion is to actually start allowing yourself to experiment with yourself emotionally. Does that make sense? Which is a very different concept, isn't it? Because most of us, well, we're so worried about making mistakes and getting something wrong and that we don't experiment with anything, let alone experiment with our emotions. Because for most of us, experimenting with our emotions seems like a painful proposition. But there's a whole groups of emotions that are all pleasurable that you can experiment with, as well as experiment with the painful emotions. Because we remember in that place that everything will pass if I just allow the experience of it. Yeah. Yeah. Laura?
Sorry, I'm just asking a very practical. So when I feel an emotion and the tears start, and I know there's more in there, but it just doesn't go there. Mm-hmm. Instead of going into the mind and going, well, what's the belief? Just stay where I'm at. Like, just stay.
Yes, every feeling that gets blocked is blocked by another feeling. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Not by a thought. It's a feeling. You need to find the feeling.
So that will dissipate if I just stay and breathe in that.
If you stay, yeah, careful of you, yeah, with you with your breathing, because you use that as a way of getting out of your body and getting away from things, right?
Okay.
But when your tears stop, there's obviously a feeling that you had that stopped them. What was it? Is what you need to find.
But I find that takes me into the mind if I go and write down and I journal and.
You can do anything you want to try and find what it is. If you need to think about it, think about it. Write about it, write about it. Sing about it, like, you know, write a lyric about it and sing a song about it. Get out a piece of drum and drum about it. Go down and punch a bag about it. Do something that will get you back to feeling what that block is. Okay. Does that make sense?
So you can use the mind like that to assist you.
Yeah, your mind's a tool God gave you to assist you to find, to eventually get to the place where you're 100% emotional. Mm-hmm. And after that, your mind is just a tool that is used by the 100% emotional soul to express itself.
The thing, Laura, I feel for you is just to be careful of feeling like, oh, I'm comfortable with saying I stopped crying because of this thing. And like you said, you get into your mind a bit, and it's okay to get into your mind if you're so unwilling to feel the next thing. If you can even identify what the next thing is, then you make it your total focus, not to get back to the emotion that was triggered, but get to the emotion that stopped you feeling the full emotion. So then my prayer then becomes, okay, I want to feel that block. Because any time I go to that other grief with my mum, it gets shut down. So what's the feeling that blocked it? I've got to get rid of that feeling block, and then it, then I'll be able to feel everything surrounding that issue much easier.
And it's obviously a feeling you don't want to feel, otherwise you would already be feeling it.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So be willing to be really real with yourself. When you find yourself, you go off and journal or lyric or whatever and say, oh, now I'm back in my mind. Go, okay, well, that's where I want to be. Let me feel about the opposite. Let me feel what it would have been like if I just stayed with it. That gets you closer to the feelings. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, from our perspective, you do need to know what is shutting you down from being a 100% emotional being. Anything you can do to find out what's shutting you down is important. Does that make sense? And if you, whatever tools you have at your disposal, use them. If, you know, a bit of body work helps you get there, go and do that. If writing gets you there, if playing some music gets you there, if whatever gets you there to that place where you were blocked, do whatever. But make sure you find out that place that blocked you. And you'll know, because the next time you cry about the same subject, it will be a full experience if you've actually let go of the block. But if it's not a full experience, then you haven't let go of the block and you know it. Does that make sense? So the emotional experience is telling you the result. It's telling you, I haven't got there yet. So allow that to be part of you. I haven't got there yet. I need to pray more about this. I need to have a stronger desire to feel it. I need to, you know, do, there's things that you can do and feel to get to that point, pray about to get to that point. But allow, like, don't detune from it. Don't run away from it. Don't ignore it now for 3 weeks, 4 weeks, month, 6 months, 12 months, whatever. Allow yourself to find it. You've found the block. Emotionally, you've found it because it's stopping you. Yeah. Now experience that block.
Make that a priority.
Once you experience that block will disappear and whatever it was blocking will start coming up. And that's basically a process that each of us can follow at any time. Yeah. Paige?
So following on from that, if you hit your block, will your law of attraction, if you pray about it, show you what that block is?
Of course. Yeah. If you're sincere in any prayer.
In wanting to.
And remember the word is that. If.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? Yep. Little word. Yeah. Big meaning. If you are sincere with any prayer, you will get a response. Yeah. So if you are sincere about finding out what the block is, you will, through the law of attraction and words that are said to you and experiences that you have, that all of which your soul is directing, you will find out what the block is.
Yeah. Okay.
If you are sincere. Yeah. The problem for many of us is that we are not really sincere. You see, what happens is, this is what happens, I find, and it's worse the more modern the times we live in, it seems. It's sort of like, if I could draw a little picture like this. So glad for whiteboards, they're so good. This is how most of us see things. We go, here's a nice highway, trying to be as smooth as possible. That is the preferred road. Is it not? But see, life's not like that highway. Life goes. Right? Now, if you were asked to get your car, and you could choose which road you want to drive on, and the majority of us would go, yeah, I think the preferred highway is the way to go, right? And you can see this one's a bit bumpy and whatever. But when it comes to a troublesome time in our life, which is like a bump in the road, right, most of us have a desire to stay there rather than to move through the troublesome period. Do you follow? And this is a definite psychological problem that we face. It's an emotional problem that we need to address. We've got to ask ourselves why we are prepared to stay in a stagnant condition rather than move forward. And the real answer is really only one answer if you think about it, isn't it? Why would you stay there? Because you're afraid of having to do that, right? So you're afraid of what's ahead. And you're also afraid of what's behind. Because you don't go back to that. You don't want to go back to that. And so what you do is you don't do anything. Right? Now, that place is not a good place for anyone. We must recognize that it's only fear that causes us to want to stay stagnant. And fear is an emotion. It's an emotional experience. So really what we're saying is we're unwilling to expand our soul enough to experience fear. Do you see that? That's really what we're saying, isn't it? By not going through the fear, we're saying to God, the universe, ourselves, we're saying, don't let me go through this fear. And that is a direct unwillingness to go through fear. That's our soul expressing its free will desire to not experience an emotion. Now, when you get into that place, you're basically saying you're not going to grow anymore. That's what you're saying. That's a place where of stagnation. And it's not a very happy place, to be honest. Yeah. So I recognize that whenever you want to be stagnant, really what you're doing is you're just honoring your fear. And if you want to become a 100% emotional being, fear is an emotion you're going to have to learn how to feel. Yeah, that didn't go down well. Did it? It's like rage is an emotion you're going to have to feel. Fear is an emotion you're going to have to feel. Terror is an emotion you're going to have to feel. Sadness is an emotion you're going to have to feel. Deep despair is an emotion you're going to have to feel. Shame is an emotion you're going to have to feel. Joy is an emotion you're going to have to feel. Happiness is an emotion you're going to have to feel. These are all emotions, if you're going to be a 100% emotional being, you're going to have to actually learn how to feel all these emotions. Right? At the moment, we see them as a bad thing to feel. But I actually see it as a expanding thing. Your soul, like when I look at the tolerance on the earth towards fear, or I should say, the intolerance to feeling fear, it blows me away because I think, wow, like most people on earth has no idea how empowering it is to actually go through the feeling of fear and to learn that you can actually do it. Mm-hmm. See, most people on earth haven't learned that they can do it. Most people on earth believe that fear is an impossible emotion to actually feel. Right? And it's not. There's like millions of people in the celestial heavens who have all felt the emotion of fear in the past, and they are all still alive. They're all still enjoying their life, so it's not an impossible emotion to feel. But on earth, it seems to be a belief system that fear and terror are impossible emotions to feel. You do everything you possibly can to avoid them. And if you even examine your own day-to-day life, even now, many of you are still doing everything you possibly can to avoid fear. Right? And that is not growing, expanding your soul to feel, to have the ability to feel fear. Once you expand your soul and allow the soul to expand, you will be able to feel fear any time. You'll be able to feel it, pass through you, release, any time. And that's a very powerful place, actually. Very powerful place. Because now, not a single decision you make will be based upon your fear. After that point, you won't base any decision on your fear anymore. And if you imagine what that would be like, you wouldn't be afraid of anything, would you? You wouldn't. And even if you were afraid, you still wouldn't base any decision on it. That'd be a pretty amazing place. Even that, even if you still had fear but you didn't any longer honour it, that'd be an amazing place. Yeah. And I feel the majority of people have no idea what that feels like. No idea what that feels like. I don't know if anyone on earth really yet has a feeling of what that feels like. Yeah. So allow the rocky road to occur, and whenever you feel stagnant on it, understand that it's fear. And if you have a feeling emotionally that you are going to become a 100% emotional being, you must go through this fear. And you'll do anything to make sure you go through the fear. You won't avoid it anymore. You won't get angry about it anymore. But if you feel anger, you'll let yourself feel it and go through that too. And then you'll come back to the fear. Whether you get angry or not, it still doesn't change the fear. It's still going to be there. You need to feel it at some point. Does that make sense?
The roads lead to different destinations, don't they?
Which ones?
The two you've drawn.
Yeah, I sort of feel like this road, which is sort of the road of comfort, is the road that the majority of us still select. And honestly, it's almost a lifeless road.
I reckon it's a loop road.
Have you been to some cities in the States where they have a freeway that goes around? Like, and London has it too, like the M25 goes around. And you just go around the city. And if you stayed on the road, it would just be like around, around, around. That's how most of our lives are. We're on this smooth road going around and around and around and around and around and around, not actually experiencing anything or going anywhere. Right? And that kind of a road is not the road you really want to be on in the long run. Yeah. You want to let the emotional experiences occur so that you can expand emotionally. And whenever you feel stagnant, you realise, I'm just afraid and I don't want to feel it. And it doesn't matter. You'll find out what you're afraid about if you really want to at some point. You won't need anyone to tell you either. Eventually you'll find it for yourself. It's handy when someone tells you, of course. Not that it helps much sometimes, because you go, okay. But I still don't want to feel it, you know. And this is the problem, is that we need to develop a desire within us to be this emotional being. And that's probably what the message we'd like to leave you with today. To start thinking about and allowing yourself to ponder about what it would be like if you lived a life that where you were 100% emotional being all the time. Allow yourself to imagine that place with God. Like, imagine swapping these emotions with God constantly, where you're always an emotional being, experiencing everything. Because the reality is, you're not being real unless you get to that place. You're not having a real experience unless you get to that place. Right? God designed that place to be your real experience. So that's the place we want to aim for in the end. Yeah. So what we'll do tomorrow is talk more with you about some of the blockages we have to get to that place, some of the belief systems that we have that we need to work out through to get to that place, and also some of the things that are a part of that place in developing desire, what it means to develop desire in certain areas where we have this emotional experience as our focus. Does that make sense? So if you want to come along tomorrow, that'd be great. Same time, probably 1:30, was it?
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, everyone.
And today's been our first presentation since the new year. So happy new year. Hope you have a productive, emotionally productive new year. And in fact, what we're trying to do with these events down here in New South Wales, you know, the assistance group events, is to actually help people understand how important the processes of getting into these emotions and allowing the emotional experience and focusing on the blockages that stop us from having these experiences. Yeah.
Yeah, and guys, I've taken 6 years to get close to this point that we're talking about today. And I've lived with someone who's been in that place that whole time. And I feel really passionately that it's great to give you guys the opportunity to spend some time around, Jesus, but also me being a little bit closer, you know, to give you the feedback, the kind of feedback that I've received long term, because it's really helped me to say, that's not it. Now you know, the work can't be done for you, and but there's no question that truth is assisting, you know, and hence assistance groups. So,
So what we want to do is help you work through some of the resistance that you have towards being an emotional being. And a lot of that is about the barter and the blackmail and the, you know, the bartering systems you have internally with other people and the addictions you want met through those systems and the belief systems that you have that you don't want to let go of because you believe them to be true and all of those kind of things. So our discussions with you will be about those subjects.
And this point that we're talking about, it's an end of sorts, but it's more a beginning of everything. And accessing wisdom from God starts at that point in a real way, and so it's a pretty exciting place to aim for. And scary, let's face it, right now we're scared.
Otherwise we'd already be there, right?
Exactly.
And even that is an emotional experience that God is trying to teach us that we're capable of experiencing.
Yeah.
As well. Like, so what I like about the whole way God's designed the soul is this soul has the capacity to infinitely expand with its emotional expression, as it does to infinitely expand in its understanding of the universe and every other subject. And what I feel for many of us is that while we're severely limiting our emotional expression, we are severely limiting the potential of our own soul. Yeah. And, you know, the sooner we can get out of that habit, the better. Yeah. Mm. And it does take some time, you know, because like I said, you're deconstructing all of these teachings that you've imbibed right from the time of conception. And it takes effort to do that. You know, it does take effort. You've got to find them, you've got to feel them. And that does take effort to do that. So, but once you've come into this desirous place, things change quite fast after that. And you know, you often ask me, what do I do in this situation? You won't have to ask me anymore. You know what I mean? You won't even think of asking anybody anymore. You'll know what to do. Through your connection with God, your connection with love, you instantly know what to do. Things that you decide now over months of time, you'll take days or even minutes to decide. Does that make sense? Like, you'll be so surprised. Like, there are decisions now that you ponder over for weeks or months on end, and you won't even spend, you know, a single moment more than a second or two on the thing in the future, because you'll know what you need to do in any circumstance. And as a result of that, your life then has the power to change very rapidly, right? So many of us have been stuck in a place for quite a number of years after hearing divine truth. And the reason why is because we've not truly engaged this understanding that actually it's our emotions that need to grow. It's our emotions that need to develop. And we need to be focused on that more than anything else. And what we're trying to do with the assistance groups is give you an experience of what it's like every day for us. Because every day, we are not focused on doing things every day. We are focused on feeling things every day. Our entire day is totally constructed to just feel things. Our entire life is constructed to feel that way, to be that way. And what we're trying to give you for 9 or 10 days is a experience of what to do the same thing if you want to do it. Yeah. So that's what our goal is there, and we don't know what's going to come of it, of course, just like we don't know what comes of most things we do. But we enjoyed the one in the States. We did one in the United States last year in, what was it?
November.
Yeah. There's some of the recordings on the internet now about that. But we had more more enjoyable discussions probably away from the camera than we did with the camera. And that's one reason why now we're going to take Lena and Eagle with us as well, because we feel like we wanted to record more of what happened down there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We finished up having probably 3 or 4 hour discussions every dinner table, didn't we? And they were more confronting for most of the people there than than the other discussions that we had with them.
So I hope everyone will be courageous and be themselves even though there's cameras around, because it really does. Wherever we go in the world, we get feedback to say thank you to people like you who do allow yourselves to be open on camera, because it helps so many other people.
So it's good. And the other thing, just to let you know what's happening, is the other things we're trying to do, with three things we're trying to do. One is to do a heap of material for new people. So we're hoping to get ready for what we feel will have an near the end of the year or later the following year. We feel there'll be an influx of people, new people, and what we want to do is get prepared for that. So we're trying to do a whole heap of material for new people. And that's the frequently asked questions. And if you haven't had a look at them, my suggestion is to have a look at them, because they're real fun to do for us, and we get to say a lot of things that we don't get to say in sessions or seminars. So, I find them like enjoyable to do. In fact, they're probably one of our favourite things to do. And then the second thing we're trying to do is help people who are stuck, who feel they're stuck. So we're trying to create a sort of a library of material that gets you over being stuck, if you like. And then the third thing we're trying to do...
playlist on YouTube.
Yeah. And then the third thing we're trying to do is just help people who we feel are progressing and have some understanding with a bit more, you know, individual attention. But it's going to be filmed. So that means that the people who are going through a bit more emotional experiences get to get help, but also it means that when the others are ready to go through those same experiences, they'll already have a library of material that will help them go through that experience. So that's what we're trying to do at the moment. We're building a studio at home at the moment to help us do the first two things, and the third thing is going to involve us travelling around to those people who we feel are a bit more unstuck and having some interactions that are filmed. So that's what our goal is over the next year or so, probably. Yeah, at the moment.
As well as embracing the emotional self.
Yeah, like for us, we're probably going to be more focused on our own progression than anything else at this stage, because there's areas that I'm a bit stuck on at the moment that I want to work my way through. So Mary's sort of fairly unstuck at the moment, just getting to the point where you... getting into desire of the emotion, aren't you, from allowance? And for me, I'm sort of just facing some emotional issues that have been around since my conception that have affected me all of my life that I'm now getting to, thank goodness, at last. But I'm finding I need a lot of private time to feel them. So that's what I'll be doing over the coming months.
I'm very fortunate in that I'm in a stage of my progress where doing stuff like this helps me with my progress. Mm. Whereas, honey, you were more through all that phase, needing just more.
I need a lot of... like, there's feelings I have now that nobody else will ever have to deal with, say, and that I need to go through the experience myself and have those feelings. And there's not many attraction events that can trigger them. I have to actually just feel them, and to do that, you've got to be in the zone of just feeling and spending some time each day making sure you feel. Yeah. So that's what I'll be doing. Yeah. Thanks for your time today, guys. Tamara, we'll catch up with you too. Yeah. It's good to see you again.